Yes, so, okay, so there are several methods to detect and characterize exoplanet. I suppose I don't have to introduce what exoplanet is. I suppose everybody knows what exoplanets are. Could you confirm that to me?
Yes.
Okay, good. So there are several methods to detect and characterize exoplanets: radial velocity, astrometry, transit, gravitational microlensing, direct imaging, light modulation, transit timing variation. I will mostly talk about radial velocities today, but I will talk a little bit about other methods, but mainly about radial velocity. So let's suppose that we look our sun. So the radial velocity is an indirect method. So I will explain the basics of that method first. So let's suppose that we are looking the sun from above the solar system at 30 light years from the sun. What we will see, a motion of the sun due to the presence of Jupiter, because Jupiter and the sun do attract them each other due to the gravitational strength. And so the sun will move with a period of 12 years, which is the orbital period of Jupiter. Of course, it's Jupiter's which moves the most. Jupiter have a large motion around the sun, but the sun has a small motion with a 12-year period. And you see the scale, it's a milliarcsecond, so it's a very tiny motion. If we look by comparison, the size of the sun, so the motion of the sun due to the presence of Jupiter is about the same order of magnitude of the scale of the size of the sun itself. And so this is a method which is astrometry. We can detect like that exoplanets with astrometry, and Gaia, the satellite, is doing that right now. But I won't talk about that now. I will talk about the radial velocity method. So let's suppose we're just on the right of that image. And we look the sun, we'll see the sun going away, approaching, going away, approaching periodically with a period of 12 years. And we can measure that in radial velocity if we see the sun approaching, going away with a period of 12 years. Actually, the true motion is not that one, because there is not only Jupiter. There is a motion due to Jupiter, but as you know, of course, there are other planets in the solar system. And the second main planet which make a motion on the sun is Saturn, with a period of 29 years. So if we look in 1975, the sun will move like that, 1980, 1995, with that, which is a combination of the motion due to Saturn and the motion due to Jupiter. So if we have an observer here observing the sun, he can detect at least Jupiter, Saturn, and the other planets by looking the motion in radial velocity with time. So this is the principle of the method. We see here we have an observer with a star and an exoplanet orbiting the star. We cannot see the planet directly because it's too faint, it's too near the star, but we can precisely see the star and see the star is approaching, going away periodically. And so we can measure that in spectroscopy using the Doppler effect. I suppose you know the Doppler effect. And so a star going away is redshifted, a star moving forward is blue shifted. And so if we report, we can measure that radial velocity in a spectroscopy. And so if we plot the measurement of the radial velocity V as a function of time, we can see the star is going away, approaching in a periodical motion. So here it's plotted not exactly as a function of the time, but as a function of the orbital phase, which is the position of the planet with respect to the star, which is periodic because there is a periodic orbit of the planets around the star. So this is the method. Once again, with that draw, we have the Earth. We observe a star with an exoplanet orbiting around. And so the star could be blue shifted when the star moving this way and red shifted when it is moving this way. And this is that method which can allow a planet to be detected. Here we see a measurement of the radial velocity, the different measurements with error bar. The star is going away, approaching, going away, approaching, going away in a periodical manner. And so sorry, I have something to remove from my screen. So the radial velocity provides the planetary mass, orbital period, and eccentricity. First, there is the semi-amplitude, which is the amplitude of the motion, so in meter per second or in kilometer per second, so in unit of velocity, of radial velocity. Sorry, I tried to remove something. I'm sorry. Okay, sorry about that. So the semi-amplitude K, so this is the amplitude here of the motion in radial velocity. As you can see, it does depend on the mass of the planet, also the mass of the star, the gravitational constant, the orbital period, and the eccentricity of the orbit. There is also a sin I. I is the inclination of the orbit. Actually, what we can see when you can measure with the radial velocity in most of cases is the lower mass of the object because there is an uncertainty due to the orientation of the orbit. I will be back to that later. So let's suppose that the planetary mass is very small by comparison to the stellar mass, which is the case in most of the cases. Of course, for a planet, it's the case. And let's suppose that the orbit is circular, so that we have I'm sorry, I have an issue. I cannot see everything on my screen, but I don't succeed to move that. So let's suppose that we have a stellar mass, which is large by comparison to the planetary mass, and a circular orbit in this with this simplification, and with k in meter per second, with the stellar, with k in meter per second, the planetary mass in Jupiter mass, the stellar mass in Sun mass, and the period in days, we have that simplification. So let's assume we have a hot Jupiter, so which was the first planet to be discovered, which is a Jupiter mass planet orbiting around its star in a few days. We have a motion of plus or minus about 100 meters per second over a few days. If now we have the true Jupiter, we have a motion of about a few meters per second over 12 years. And let's suppose we have an Earth, we have a motion of about 10 centimeters per second over 1 year period, just by applying that formula. And so to define a Keplerian orbit with that, so we have the radial velocity as a function of time, we have the six parameters of the Keplerian orbit. The first one is the orbital period. We see the signal is periodic, so there is the period. The second parameter is the eccentricity of the orbit. I will be back about that later. The second one is the longitude of the periastron, which is the orientation of the orbit with respect to the sky if we have an eccentricity. The fourth one is the epoch of periastron, so to see at which time, at which epoch the planet is at a given place on the orbit. The fifth one is the semi-amplitude of the radial velocity, so the amplitude here of the motion. And the last one is the systemic radial velocity, the average radial velocity of the star, because the star will have a motion going away with modulation to the planet or moving forward and plus another motion due to the planets. So the first discovery of a planet was made using this method. It was made at Observatoire de Provence here in France. It was made by Michel Mayer and Didier Queloz in 1995, so two astronomers from Switzerland. And they, as you probably know, they obtained the Nobel Prize in Physics 2 years ago because of that terrific discovery. So here is the result they obtained. So this is the same curve that I show you. So this is the historical curve of Meyer and Kellos published in 1995. So this is the observation of the star 51 Peg, and they discover the planet 51 Peg B with that motion of the star. Here are the measurements they did at Observatoire de Provence using the spectrograph Elodie. They measure a period of 4.2 days, an amplitude of 56 meters per second, which corresponds the period and the amplitude to 0.46 Jupiter masses. So this is a planet as massive as Jupiter, so a giant planet, but not in a 12 years period as our Jupiter, but a very short period, a period of 4.2 days. So it's very near the star. Here behind, we have an artistic view of the planet with the star, which is very near the planet. So it is very hot. So we call such kind of planet hot Jupiter. And it was a surprise because such kind of planets, hot Jupiter, are not known at all in a solar system. If there would have been hot Jupiter in a solar system, we would have discovered it. So there are no hot Jupiter in a solar system. Actually, now, 25 years after, we know that it's likely less than 1% of stars in our galaxy probably do have hot Jupiter. So hot Jupiter are not very common planets. They are quite rare, less than 1% of stars. So it's not a surprise that our sun does not have a hot Jupiter. So soon after the first discovery in 95, it was the second discovery. So the first discovery was made in Europe. So as I told you, by astronomer from Swiss using an observatory in France and using an instrument, Elodie, the spectrograph, which was common from France and Switzerland. The second planet was discovered by a researcher from USA in 96, so the year after. So here again, we see the radial velocity as a function of the time. You see the years of the observation here and the variation of the star due to the presence of a planet. So a period of slightly more than 1,000 days, an amplitude of 47.7 meters per second, which corresponds to about 2.4 Jupiter masses. Another one, which was interesting, published in 97, again by the researcher from the US, is that planet around Upsilon Andromeda. We see again the radial velocity as a function of the orbital phase. So the planet is approaching, going away, approaching, going away. So here it's a classical hot Jupiter, the mass 0.7 Jupiter masses, the period 4.6 days. And what is interesting, of course, in science is to look the measurements. Here we see the measurements and behind the Keplerian model with that curve. And if we remove the curve, the model, the Keplerian model from the measurements, we can look the residual. And the residuals, they look like that. So here is the same planet, Upsilon Andromeda, the radial velocity as a function of time, but once we remove the effects of the hot Jupiter, the 4.6 day planet is removed. And when we see that, we still see some variation of the radial velocity, and we see two additional radial velocity motion, that one at short period, as you can see, and another one with a longer period. So actually in that planetary system, there are three planets, at least three planets, the one at 4.6 day, the one here and the one here at longer period. So if we see that system, the Upsilon Andromeda system from above, we have the planet B, the planet C, and the planet D. So it was the first multiplanetary system to be discovered. And we see it is at the same scale of the inner solar system. Here, we see the scale here in astronomical units. If the sun is here, we have the orbit of Mercury, Venus, the Earth, and Mars. And on the same scale, the planet Upsilon Andromeda B, Upsilon Andromeda C, and Upsilon Andromeda D. So it is the same scale of the inner solar system, but of course, there are not telluric planets are in the solar system. These three planets here are giant gaseous planets. As I told you earlier, the The radial velocity method allows also the eccentricity of the orbit to be measured. Here we have an example with a circular orbit, so an eccentricity near zero. So we have a radial velocity curve, which is regular, I will say. The radial velocity moves slowly. If we look now on eccentric orbits, here we see that planet, HD16175b, which is highly eccentric, an eccentricity of 0.64. We see the radial velocity curve change less regularly because due to the Kepler laws, when the planet is nearer the star, the motion is faster, and when the planet is away, is far from the star, the motion is slower. Here another example, which that case, I will try if I have time to talk a little bit more about that, that very interesting system, HD80606, the planet B. The eccentricity is 0.993, which is one of the system with the highest eccentricity. We see the radial velocity. The radial velocity, again, as a function of the orbital phase, slow motion and a fast motion just when the planet is near the star, and again after a slow motion. We see the orbit here. So the planet is moving this way. You see when it goes near the star, it's very fast, and after the motion is slower. So near the star is that part of the radial velocity curve. Here is a review of the different eccentricity of the different planets which were measured. You see thousands of planets here. We see a large scale of eccentricity. You see eccentricity zero, so the circular planets are here. You see that you know that in the solar system, most of the planets are nearly circular, of small eccentricities, O1, O2 in the solar system, but we don't have planets with large eccentricity in the solar system. Here, for exoplanetary system, we have large eccentricity. Eccentricities for some system, we suppose that these eccentricities, the large eccentricities, are due to interaction between planets themselves, sometimes planets with other stars, and also interaction between planets and the protoplanetary disk. And the low eccentricity for hot Jupiter, we see at here we have the orbital period, so here there are the planets closing to their star. Due to their strong interaction with their star, we know that the orbit should be circularized. So here, most of the planets at short periods have low eccentricities. Here we have an histogram, not an histogram, a review of all the planets discovered since 1995. So the first one was here, as a function of the radial velocity semi-amplitude. So what we can see is that it decreases with time. With time, we can reach more and more accurate radial velocities measurement. It's due to the improvement of the instrumentation. We see it's less clear since 2010, 2015. Now maybe we reach a floor, a limit, when it's difficult to go below. It's a few tenths of centimeter per second, because below that limit, we have a strong stellar effect, the variation of the surface of the star. We have a few centimeter, 10 centimeter effects, which can make it difficult to detect the planets. But there are work to do to try to go below that limit ongoing. Here an example of a very accurate radial velocity measurement. It was published a few years ago by colleagues using ARPS. ARPS is the spectrograph at ISO in Chile with a 3.6 meter telescope. As you can see in that system around the star HD2794, four planets were detected with orbital period of 80 days, 40 days, 90 days. And we see the amplitude of the motion is below 1 meter per second. The unit is meter per second. It's below 1 meter for that one, and for that one also. And three planets are detected, corresponding to about 2.7, 2.4, and 4.8 Earth masses. And the dispersion around that fit is below 1 meter per second. So they are very accurate measurements. ARPS, the ARPS spectrograph, is one of the most accurate spectrograph in the world right now. So the key point to improve radial velocity accuracies for a spectrograph: first, we need an accurate wavelength calibration. on short and long time scales, short time scale to see short orbital period, and long time scale of several years to detect planets away far from their star. So to do wavelength calibration, we can do absorption cells using, for example, iodine in a cell, holocathode emission lamp using, for example, species thorium argon, Fabry-Pérot interferometer, laser combs. All these techniques are used in different spectrographs to do accurate wavelength calibration. We need high spectral resolution. So with low spectral resolution, it's not possible to do accurate radial velocity measurements. We do a very good instrument stability on short and long time scales. Again, so for that, most of the instruments are regularized. There are regulation systems both for temperature and pressure of the instrument, of the spectrograph. Some of them are even put in a vacuum tank in order it's particularly stable. We need an accurate injection of the light of the star in the spectrograph, good scrambling, good guiding of the telescope. And also it's useful to have good spectral diagnostic, for example, for the stellar activity. As I told you, we have a stellar activity effect on the radial velocity. So we have to have diagnostic to study that. Also to study the rotation period of the star, because rotation effects on the star could produce effects on the measure radial velocity. And we need a large number of measurements with high signal to noise ratio, because we need a lot of measurements to be able to detect such kind of radial velocity motion. So there are numerous ongoing radial velocity surveys and instruments around the world. I put it some example here. Maybe the last one, the most accurate, is the Espresso spectrograph on the VLT at ESO. The VLT is a telescope or four telescope of 8.2 meters. So it's a gigantic telescope with a very accurate spectrograph. So there are several ones. I will talk to you more today about one of them, the SOFI spectrograph at OHP. By the way, I'm right now at OHP, at Observatoire de Haute-Provence. I'm talking from here. So the Haute-Provence Observatory, this is the location where Mayer and Queloz did the first discovery in 1995. So it's located here in France, and you can see the observatory. So the telescope is here, the 193 centimeter telescope, which is over here. By the way, right now I'm here, just over here in that office, talking to you right now. So the dome is here. This is the same dome I see, and we see the telescope here. So the SOFI spectrograph is a cross-dispersed Echelle spectrograph. Observing is the optical wavelength. It's the environment of the spectrograph is stabilized both in temperature and pressure. The dispersive element is a tank with constant pressure and temperature, which is here, the tank. It's optical fiber fade. So there are optical fiber going from the telescope to the spectrograph. The optical fibers, we see them over here in gray here. They put the lights here into the spectrograph. We do the calibration with thorium lamp and with the Fabry-Pérot instruments. We have two modes, spectral resolution 40,000 or 75,000, and two fiber sets per mode. Each fiber set could look the star that we observe, the sky towards the background, or calibration lamp. The first light of the spectrograph was done in 2006 at the 193 centimeter telescope at OHP. And several upgrades were done in 2010, 2014, and we are right now doing a new upgrade. Here, an example of one of the upgrades. In 2011, we put octagonal section fiber in SOFI. SOFI was the first instrument in the world to have that. And you see that the measurement of radial velocity as a function of time, SOFI plus in red is after we put the octagonal section fiber, and in black before, we see that the accuracy is clearly better after the octagonal section fiber has put. The octagonal section fiber allow a good crumbling of the image of the star inside the optical fiber. So it allow, as you can see, clearly a better accuracy. So to measure the stellar radial velocity, we use here at OHP the cross correlation method. so that works that way. First, we have Sophie is an Eschel spectrograph, so we have the different order of the spectrum here. The wavelength is going up, down from a low wavelength and larger wavelength here, the same in that direction. So we have the spectra. So we extract the spectra from that 2D image. So we have the spectra in 1D. So the flux as a function of the wavelength. And with that, we do a cross dispersion, which is a numerical mask that we cross correlates with the spectra. So at the, and we move with as a function of the wavelength of the radial velocity. And we construct the radial velocity, the CCF, like that. Here is the cross correlation function, the CCF. In red, this is the result. And in green, this is the Gaussian fit of that cross correlation function, the CCF. And so that cross correlation function, which is the flux as a function of the radial velocity, the Gaussian fit in green allow the radial velocity to be measured. So here, the radial velocity is written, it's 16.4, we see, in kilometer per second. And it allows also a lot of other measurements to be done, the bisector of the CCF, the full width at half maximum. The full width at half maximum could be translated in the Visan eyes, so the projected rotation stellar velocity, and also the metallicity. We can do a lot of measurements using the CCF method, so that's why it's broadly used around the world, and in particular at Observatoire de Provence. So some example of discovery made with Sophie using that technique. We see the, that star here, published in 2016, the radial velocity as a function of time. We see in green, there are whole LOD measurements, and in red, the Sophie measurements. So over several years, we see the planet is going away, approaching. So the period is 3.2 years, the mass 1.6 Jupiter masses. Another example here with that planet, a period of 1.7 years, a mass likely below the Jupiter mass. And another example here, a very long period planet, 10 years, for Jupiter masses, so a period almost as long as the period of Jupiter. And that one, the one on the top, is interesting because if we look in green here, what we call the habitable zone, so which is the zone where the planet is not too near the star. If the star, the planet is near the star, it's too hot and the water water does evaporate. If the planet is too far from the star, it's too cold and the water is in ice form, in solid form. If it is in the green area here, which is the habitable zone, the temperature could be not too low and not too high in order for water to be liquid. So of course, this is a giant planet. You see 1.6 Jupiter masses. So that planet is unlikely to be habitable, but we can imagine that there could be some satellites around that planet. And so some telluric satellites will be in the habitable zone. So maybe some satellites around that, that planet might be habitable. Another example of detection with SOFIE, the warm Neptune HD164595. We see again the radial velocity as a function of the time. There is a drift, but if we remove that long-term drift, there is a variation as a function of time. So the small variation here, the parameter of the planet is 40-day period, an amplitude of 3 meters plus. 3 meters per second, corresponding to a mass of 16 Earth masses. And one last example with Sophie here. Here, that planet around a red dwarf star. We see the variation here, the radial velocity again as a function of time. You see it's a tiny motion, but with a statistical method, we can be sure that the signal is significant. The orbital period is slightly below 13 days, a K of 1.6 meters per second, corresponding to about 3 Earth masses. And that planet is interesting because it is very near the Sun. The planet that we see here is GLIS, GL14111b. and it is very near the sun. You see the distance in parsec, it's 2.5 parsec from our sun. And actually, this is the third, in terms of distance, this is the third known planet. The nearest is here, Proxima Centauri B. After, there is Barnard Stars B, and the third one is GL1411b, which is very near our sun. It's interesting because you see it's not in the habitable zone. The habitable zone is here, you see. So Proxima Centauri is in the habitable zone. That one is slightly above, so it's too cold to be habitable, but probably it's a telluric planet. We don't have the size of the planet. We just have its mass, three Earth's masses. Probably it's a telluric planet. We see here the habitable zone of around that star and the orbit of that planet. So here is a picture of all the planets that we detected with radial velocity, the thousands of planets that we detected. We see them as a function of their mass in Earth masses on a logarithmic scale and are a function of their orbital period in days, again, on a logarithmic scale. In red, we see the planets of the solar system, Mercury, Venus, the Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. So what we can see is that we and in black, there are the exoplanets known, the known exoplanets. So we see that we have planets similar to Jupiter, maybe some planets nearly similar to Saturn, but we don't have planets similar to Uranus and Neptune. We don't have exoplanets similar to the telluric planets in the solar system. So that doesn't mean that these planets do not exist around other stars and our sun. That means that all that area, we did not explore it yet because it's difficult to discover exoplanets in that area. But if we look the planets, the exoplanets that we discovered already in 25 years, we see that there is a large, there are planets in a large game, but of parameters for mass and period, but not everywhere. We see three families. Probably you see these three families. There is one family here, and a last family here. So I will talk to you briefly about those three families. So first, that family here, there are planets of a few thousand Earth masses and a few days period. So those planets are hot Jupiters. So planets of the mass of Jupiter, giant planets, but orbiting in a few days around their star. So we see the hot Jupiter here, hot Jupiters. Here we see planets with about the same mass, so giant planets, but with orbital period of few hundred, few thousand days, few years, few 10 years. So these planets, they are giant planets more similar to our Jupiters. So I will say temperated giant planets. It's interesting to see that we see a lot of planets here. We see a lot of planets here, but we see less planets here. So there is a kind of giant planet desert here. Is not a total desert because we see some planets, but not a lot of planets. And of course, there are a lot of observational biases here because the planets here are less difficult to detect than the planets here, and the planets here are less difficult to detect than the planets here. So the fact that we see a lot of planets here doesn't mean that these planets are very abundant. That means that the planets are the easier to detect because they have larger amplitude in radial velocity on a shorter time scale, a few days. So as I told you, they are not very abundant. Our Jupiters are present for slightly less than 1% of stars. But the planets here, they are easier to detect than the planets here. The planets here are more difficult to detect than the planets here. But still, we see more planets here than here. So that means that here, really, there is a lack of planets. So in period between 10 days and 100 days, something like that, there is a lack of giant planets and there are more planets here. So that observation is a very important observation because it provides input for the model of formation and evolution of planetary system, of giant planets in particular. Actually, we know that it is not possible to form planets, to form giant planets nearby to the star because there are too much energy arriving from the star. So actually, the model which is expected now is that giant plants form here. And after, some of them, maybe most of them, do migrate, so change orbits. And a lot, some of them end here in a giant, in a hot Jupiter form. So the planets form here, giant planets, and some of them move inwards towards their star. It's not clear now why some of them stop and some of them probably fall directly onto their star and disappear. And so the last planet population here is here. You see, there are planets of a few tens Earth masses. So there are planets between the mass of the Earth. You see, it's slightly above the mass of the Earth and Venus, and on to the mass of Uranus and Neptune, and slightly below, so a few Earth masses. So they are very abundant. Actually, again, these planets are more difficult to detect than these planets. But we see more planets here. So that means that here, really, these planets are very abundant. And here, there is a lack of planets. So there are two families of planets. I will say the giant planets at large and shorter periods, and those planets that we call the sub-Neptunes, because they are slightly below the mass of Neptune, or the super-Earths, because they are slightly above the mass of the Earth. And that population is very interesting. Just drink a little bit. That population is very interesting because, as I told you, these planets are more difficult to discover because the amplitude in radial velocity is small. So we need a lot of observation to detect them, so we don't detect a lot of them. It is not easy to detect some of them. But B, despite that difficulty, a lot of planets are detected in that area. So when we try to correct for the observational biases, we can evaluate the number of planets per star. As I told you, here is slightly less than one star, 1% of the stars that have hot Jupiter. If we look here, it's around 10-20% of stars that have temperate Jupiters. If we look here, actually, we see that almost all stars have planets in that regime. So these planets, the super Earth and the sub-Neptunes, are very common in our galaxies. So it's a very interesting result because those planets were not known before, because there is one star when we don't have such kind of planets, which is our sun. So it's very interesting to see that super Earth and sub-Neptunes, they are very abundant, but around our sun, there is no super Earth and sub-Neptune. If there would have been a super Earth or sub-Neptune, we would have discovered it, but we did not, so they're absent. In the solar system, we have the Earth and Venus, we have Uranus and Neptune, and between them, in terms of NAF, we have nothing. Around all the other stars, we see a lot of planets in that regime, so it's a very interesting result, I would say. I will skip that and maybe talk a little bit about transits, but I don't know how long I have. I'm supposed to talk up to which hour. Could you let me know? Il reste encore une demi-heure, c'est ça?
Oui.
Okay, so I will end at 1:40. So, no, sorry, at 12:40, so we can discuss a little bit if there are some questions. So just to end, I will talk to about another method, which is the transit method. When we have a star and a planet, the orbit of the planet is well aligned, so the planets transit just in front, passes just in front of the star. We have a transit, which is a kind of eclipse, as we have on Earth. Of course, we cannot see that because the star is too far, so we don't see the surface of the star. The star is just a point, but we can measure the brightness of the star, the magnitude of the star, and if we see that the brightness decreases and is back normal after for a few hours, and if that drop in the brightness of the star, in the light curve of the star, is periodical, we can conclude that a body is transiting in front of the star periodically, so it's orbiting around the star, so we can say that there is a planet transiting in front of the star. And so the first detection of an exoplanet transit was made in 95, published in 2000, in the case of that star, HD 209458, which is a very famous star because it has an hot Jupiter. The hot Jupiter was detected by different spectrograph, including LOD at Observatoire de Provence. We have the radial velocity curve as a function of time. So the period is 3.5 days, the semi-amplitude 87 meters per second, corresponding to about 0.7 Jupiter masses. It's a quite bright star with a 7.4 magnitude. And so that planet discovered in radial velocity, we did not know what was the orientation, the inclination of the orbit, but actually the orientation was 90 degrees. The planet was just transiting, passing in front of the star. So here is the first, the same planet detected by Charbonneau et al., also by Henri et al. After. We have here not spectroscopy, but photometry, the relative flux. So each point, the photometry as a function of the time during a night in September 1999. So no variation of the flux of the star. The star, the flux drop and come again after back, come back to the unity. So here we have the transit of the planets. The planet is just, just passing in front of the star with a depth of slightly more than 1%, corresponding to about one Jupiter radius. It was a very important result because the transit is an independent method by comparison to radial velocity. So it was the proof that the radial velocity variation are in effect due to planets. Actually, it was some controversy, some discussion. For example, Gray et al. In 97 wrote a paper saying that it was there were interesting variations in stellar line in 51 peg with a period of 4.2 days. So it could be some interesting variation of the stellar line, which make us believe that there is a planet. Actually, it was not a planet, but it was not confirmed. And the case of the planetary transit, here we have a transit for a planet. So the planet is detected both in radial velocity and in transit. So it is really a confirmation that the radial velocity variation are due to planets orbiting stars. And so after that, after the discovery of the first planet in 2000, of the first planet in transit, that planet here, it was first discovered in radial velocity, as you can see here, and after it was discovered, it was confirmed in transit. But so other strategy is possible. We can try to look directly transiting planets. But a transit, of course, a planetary transit is rare because to have a transit, we have the planet, we have to pass just in front of the star. If the planet passes above or under the star, you have no transit. So the transit technique is not a very efficient technique in terms that most of the exoplanets do not transit. So in order to detect an event which is rare, the solution, a good strategy, is to observe a lot of stars. If you observe thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands stars, and you follow their light curve with time, you have a chance for some of them to see a small drop of the light curve and to detect a planet. So there are a lot of photometric surveys. So observing tens of thousands of stars with in photometry to discover possible drops due to planets. However, a drop in a light curve do not necessarily correspond to a planet. It could be due to other astrophysical scenarios. So to that, we need radial velocity follow-up, and I will end with that about radial velocity, about the radial velocity follow-up of transiting planetary candidates from photometric survey. Because so the goal of that is to establish the nature of a transiting event. Because when we have a transit light curve, it looks like that. Here you have candidates from the WASP experiment. You have the flux of the star as a function of the time, and you see a drop here, another case here, another star, a drop here, a drop here. So all this drop, it could be due to planets, but not necessarily, because it could be due to grazing eclipsing binaries. If you have a star transiting with a grazing transit, another star, it could look like a planetary transit. You can also have an eclipsing M dwarf. So a small size stars, so it could be a star with the same size than a planet, but it's not a planet, it's a star. You can have also background eclipsing binaries, blending eclipsing binaries. Actually, there are several scenarios which could mimic a planetary transit like curve, but it's not a light curve. But in some cases, of course, it could be also transiting planets. So actually, from ground-based photometric surveys, only 1 to 10% of the candidates are planets. Most of them are false positive rates, are false positives. So we need radial velocities to establish if it is a planet or not. So the goal of radial velocity follow-up of transiting planet candidates from photometric surveys is first to establish the nature of transiting events. The second is to measure the mass of the secure planet, because the transit provides the radius and the radial velocity provides the mass. Measure the eccentricity. As I show you, the radial velocity method allows the eccentricities of the orbits to be measured. To determine the host star parameters with a spectral analysis. Measure spin orbit angle, but I think I will be too short. I won't have time to discuss about that. Or also to detect long-term variation in radial velocity to see if there are additional planets in the system. So just to finish, as I will be soon at the end of my talk, of my presentation, I will present you a recent discovery that we made with colleagues from SuperWAST and Sophie here at Observatoire d'Haute-Provence. So I will present you the discovery of the system WASP-148, so which is the discovery of a multiplanetary system in strong interaction. So that system, the candidate was first discovered by the SuperWAST photometry survey. The SuperWAST survey, it's an experiment led by our colleagues from Great Britain. And they use that instrument, which is, you see, 8 telescopes. They are very small telescopes. They are about 10 centimeter size. And so why that small size is to have a large field. The SuperWASP experiment, it did survey tens of thousands of stars to measure their light curve to see if there are hints of if there are possible detection of transiting planets. And that experiment reported in June 2008, June 2010, and May 2011 a possible transit of a planet. You see the flux of the star as a function of time, a possible drop here, a possible drop here, a possible drop here. As you can see, the detection is very tiny. It's not clear at all that we have a detection. But from statistical argument, our colleague from SuperWAST told us that we could have a planet here. So we did observe that star with Sophie, so WASP-148. So here is observation over several years, the radial velocity of that star as a function of the time, and the Keplerian motion. Actually, as you can see, there are not one, but two Keplerian here, the residual here. To see better here, I show you to zoom on the curve here. You see here a variation at a short period and a variation at longer period here. And the same here, a variation at short period and a variation at longer period. So actually, there are two planets in that system. The first one is WASP-148b, which have a period of 8.8 days, which is the one which was here, that period here between these 3 days, this three transits is 8.8 days. So we measure the mass with that curve. It's 0.29 Jupiter masses. And from the transit, we have the size of the planet, 0.72 Jupiter radii. And there is another planet, a second planet with a longer period, the one here with a longer period at 34 days period and a mass of 0.4 Jupiter masses. So there are two giant planets, a kind of a Saturn-like planets, but on short period. And what is interesting in that system is that that period is about 4 times shorter than that one. So that system is near the resonance, the 1-4 resonance. And the prediction is that we can have variation, there are strong interaction between both planets, so we can have a small variation of the orbital parameter, for example, the orbital period. So to see that, we observe new transits. Here we have new photometric transits of the band. So the three first ones that I show you earlier by WASP, which are not very accurate, five other ones which are more accurate, and you can see them here. And here you can measure at each light curve the center of the transit, so we can measure the period. And so here we have eight transits, so we have eight dates of transits. So we put here the date of the eight transits, which is each instrument here. And here is the residual. If we assume that the period is uniform, the orbital period of planet B is uniform, so there are no variations. And you can see that there are variations by comparison to that. For example, that transit occurred 30 minutes earlier than what was expected. Is it due to the fact that there are interactions between both planets in a stronger interaction because they are near the resonance? And so I will skip that. I will just show you to end some prediction of how should evolve the inclination of the orbit of planet B and planet C. You see that over a few hundred of years, due to the interaction of the two planets, the orbital plan of both planets does vary with time. So you see over a few hundred years, the inclination varies. We have just transit here when it's near 90 degrees. So actually, within about 200 years, the planet won't transit anymore, and it will transit again within about 600 years. And here, to have a transit of the planet C, you have to be around 90 degrees, and the planet is not around that value, so that planet won't transit. So I propose to end now, and just to conclude, I will say you that the pioneering radial velocity method remain an efficacious technique to detect and characterize exoplanets. We can increase the parameter space of the parameter of the planets that we discover to reach lower planetary masses, longer orbital periods, broader stellar types. And if I talk about SOFIE, I talk a lot about SOFIE at Observatoire de Haute-Provence. Now it's reached 1 to 2 meter accuracy for low mass planets around bright star with a 2 meter telescope with numerous available nights. For giant planets, we can probe star down to magnitude 15 and even fainter for binary stars. We are a lot of upgrades of the instrument. We'll change the detector soon, change the fiber in order to improve capabilities. Now, SOFIE contributed to the characterization of more than 150 planets. We are ongoing surveys to our different types of stars. We have ongoing follow-up of photometric survey from ground and also space. I didn't talk about space-based photometric surveys with Kepler, now with TESS, in the future with Plato, but of course it will be an important, it is an important program also in the future, so we'll do a lot of radial velocity follow-up for this program. And yes, it's planned to go, it's go on TESS already, and it's planned to go on Plato also in the future for SOFIE. So I propose to stop here. I thank you for hearing me, and if you have some questions, some comments, I will be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jan. So, we wait for questions, please. So, I can begin. I have a question. Here in Ukraine, we have a manipulation of spectral photometry, and we do especially variable stars and with the small telescope, we can contribute to mini campaign to observe radial, variable star, and we can measure variable radial velocity. How do you see that we can contribute to this method transit, for example, right?
Yes, it's interesting. Could you let me know what is the size of your telescope and what is the typical accuracy in radial velocity that you can reach?
Sure, we are limited in the flow, so in signal and the resolution. So about aperture, we have a need 16 inch, and for spectrograph we have 12,000. Parameter resolution.
Okay, but do you have an idea of the radial velocity in meter or kilometer per second that you can reach? I suppose it's a few kilometers per second accuracy, I suppose.
Around that, I think so.
Yeah, so I suppose with the size of the telescope. So it's not possible to detect planets with such accuracy, but what could be possible is to detect binary stars. And binary stars, they are interesting for themselves, but they are also interesting because you know that now we detect some planets orbiting binary stars. So for such cases, it could be interesting to better characterize the binary stars themselves. So I suppose with your instrumentation, it might be possible to do that, yes.
Okay, thank you very much. So question from Iben, from Tunisia.
Bonjour Guillaume, merci pour la présentation, c'est riche et pertinente. Ma question ressemble à celle de M. Benhida. En fait, pour les systèmes multiples à double ou triple, comment on fait la comparaison ou la séparation entre le spectre des étoiles elles-mêmes ou du système stellaire et la séparation avec le système planétaire?
Alors en fait, dans ce que j'ai montré en vitesse radiale, ce que l'on voit, c'est uniquement l'étoile. Donc, on a uniquement le spectre de l'étoile. Évidemment, il y a un petit spectre de la planète également, mais ce spectre, il est négligeable. On voit essentiellement le spectre de l'étoile. Donc, en fait, pour les mesures en vitesse radiale, le spectre planétaire n'est pas une difficulté. Par contre, ce que vous avez dit, vous avez parlé de systèmes multiples. En effet, on peut avoir plusieurs planètes qui tournent autour d'une même étoile. Et dans ce cas-là, j'ai montré quelques cas dans ma présentation, les variations dues aux différentes planètes vont être mélangées. On voit uniquement l'étoile, mais l'étoile va avoir plusieurs composantes dans son mouvement dues aux différentes planètes. Et là, en effet, c'est une difficulté. Parfois, ce n'est pas facile. Quand on a une seule planète qui tourne autour d'une étoile, là, c'est plus simple parce qu'a priori, on a une seule période, une seule variation, donc on peut plus facilement la trouver. Quand on a plusieurs périodes qui se mélangent, ça devient plus compliqué. Et pour s'en tirer, il faut faire beaucoup de mesures et des mesures précises pour réussir à distinguer les différentes périodes qu'on voit dans les variations de vitesse radiale. Et ce qui peut être très difficile, c'est si on a des planètes de masse similaire, de périodes similaires, là, ça va être vraiment difficile de les distinguer. Donc, c'est une difficulté dans ce cas-là.
Sorry, how can you distinguish between the spectra of the different binary stars?
Can you answer this? Yeah, you can come around there.
Can you tell us how you distinguish between different spectra of the stars? Because it's a binary star, so you have to start.
Okay, sorry. I answer in French. I can answer in English. Yes.
Yeah,
so I was saying that actually, when we measure the radial velocity of the star, we just see the star. Of course, there is a small perturbation due to the planets in the spectra itself. I will say we see a little bit the spectrum of the planets, but it's really negligible by comparison to the spectrum of the star. So when we look a star, we mainly see the spectrum of the star. So we just see the star. So here, there is no difficulty. There is no mix between the spectrum of the star and the spectrum of the planets. Actually, the spectrum of the planet is negligible by comparison to the spectrum of the star. Where it could be difficult if we have several planets in the system. Because if we have just one planet in the system, so we see the spectra of the star, we see a motion of the star in the spectrum, so that with just one motion, one period, it's easier. If we have several planets, let's say we just have two planets, we have two periods, two amplitudes, so it's difficult to distinguish between both.
I'm sorry, my question was about how can you differentiate between, you have a binary system, a star orbiting around a star, another star. And so you say that,
what is
the two spectra of the different stars. We have two stars.
Okay. So if you have a binary, sorry, I misunderstood your question. If you have a binary stars, actually there are two cases. There are cases when both stars have a similar flux. So actually you see two spectrum, two sets of stellar lines. So it could be difficult, but actually it's not so difficult. you see, I show you the coarse correlation function. So you have the spectrum of the star, and you cross correlate it with a numerical mask, and you have a Gaussian, a cross correlation function, which gives you the radial velocity of the star. Actually, if you have two stars, a binary star, your cross correlation function just will have two peaks. You will have two Gaussians. And in most of cases, you can resolve both Gaussians. When you can have a difficulty is if the radial velocity of both stars is similar, so the two Gaussian will be mixed and it might be difficult to distinguish both of them.
Okay,
and
thank you.
Of cases for binary stars, if when you have a star which is clearly brighter than the other one, in that case, you just see one one set of stellar lines. You see it moves a lot because it is a binary, but you're not perturbed by the secondary star. And it's very frequent. There are a lot of binary stars when one of both stars is clearly brighter than the other one.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have another question. Can you avoid this?
Thank you for your nice presentation. I'm a PhD student working on the detection and characterization of exoplanets. Doing radial velocity observations is quite difficult when the planet size or when the exoplanet doesn't have an sufficient mass to make a great radial velocity signal. So, but we still do observations, radial velocity observations, just to make sure that the transit signal is due to a transiting planet, but not other things like eclipsing binary. So we do an upper limit on the mass from exactly. Radial velocity. I want to just understand how can we do that. Thank you.
Yes, okay. Thank you. So you say when we have a candidate of a planet due to a transit, you see a transit-like curve and you know that you have you suspect you have a small size planet. So you try to establish the transit is due to a planet by doing radial velocity. Actually, the other scenario, if it's not a planet, it could be a binary star. So if it's a binary star, the variation in radial velocity will be large. And you should detect that in radial velocity. So if you see no variation in radial velocity, it's a sign that it is a planet that was transiting, and you can just put an upper limit on the mass because you see no variation. And you see with a planetary mass larger than a given limit, you will see a variation in radial velocity of a given semi-amplitude, and you determine what is the smallest radial velocity variation that you can measure according to the accuracy of your instrument, of your spectrograph, and you can derive the corresponding mass, which will be the upper limit for the mass. And if the mass is smaller, you can just not detect it. Just we have to be careful here because if we do not detect the radial velocity motion, actually there are some scenario, for example, of a blended binary star, if you have a binary star, but these two stars are blended in the light of a third star. So in that case, there are some scenarios when even in radial velocity, you won't see large motion, and it will be difficult to conclude. So it's not an easy problem.
So oh, thank you.
Oui, monsieur. Vas-y,
Bonjour, Guillaume, c'est moi encore une fois. C'est une question qui n'est pas technique. Comment vous interprétez les résultats et la diversité, les différents systèmes solaires déjà découverts? Et le fait que le système solaire figure une exception et qui est unique dans tout ce monde-là. Votre interprétation.
Oui. Vous voulez que je réponde en français ou en anglais?
Comme vous voulez. Je comprends l'anglais, mais j'en parle pas.
OK. Bon, I will answer in English. So if there are people who don't speak French. So the question was how I do interpret the fact that the solar system apparently is particular. That's true that it is, I present that in my presentation. It's very surprising. It's a big surprise that most of the exoplanets that we discover are very different from what we see in the solar system. That doesn't mean that all the planets that we have in our solar system, probably they do exist in other planetary systems. Just they are difficult to detect for now, so we cannot say that the planets that are currently in our solar system do not exist in around other stars. Actually, I think it's likely, I'm ready to bet a lot of money that we can that there exists exo-Mercury, exo-Venus, exo-Earth, exo-Mars, exo-Jupiter, and so on around other stars. I think that do exist. What is surprising is that there are a lot of planets, in particular the super-Earth and the sub-Neptune, that do exist. They are very numerous, very abundant around other stars, and they are not present in the solar system. So how I do interpret that, I'm not sure I have a good answer. It's difficult. It's a big surprise. I will say that I'm still surprised by that result. I'm still surprised, and I don't have good answer. I know that I have some colleagues, it's not my case, but I have some colleagues working on evolution models from planetary systems, and they are able to explain why, for example, how Jupiter and Saturn, they did clean most of the orbits, and so probably they did remove a lot of planets if they were existing before. So they can explain, they can have some scenarios to explain that. And I do not say they are not good scenarios. I think they are, this is good physics and they work a lot on that. And I think they are interesting models. But still, it's surprising that there is a low probability that such scenario did occur. So I'm sorry, I have no answer. My answer is that I'm still surprised by that. And no, I have no answer. It's one of the most interesting results in science for years. The planets, the most abundant planets that we see in the galaxy do not exist in the solar system. I think no astronomers did predict that. I think nobody did predict that. It's very a huge surprise. And I have no answer. I'm sorry for that.
Okay, Glenn, can you introduce yourself?
Sure. So thank you for a great presentation. My name is Victor, and I'm from Nigeria. I'm fairly new to the study of exoplanets, and I don't know if this is a good question, but I was listening keenly when you talk about eccentricity and in terms of the exoplanet being very close to the star, in terms of observation, how is it clear, or how shall we not mistaken it for a binary, at that point in time, mistaken it for a binary star movement?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I have understood your question. You talk about the nearby planets and the eccentricity, but I'm not sure I understood your question. Sorry.
So when the exoplanet is closest to the star, if you're observing at that point in time, you're probably having a reception that gives you an impression that you are observing a binary star, because at that time it's closest to the sun and it's probably almost exhibiting the same spectrum or something.
Yes, I'm not sure I fully understood, but what you say, if I understood a little bit, you say that we are not sure that the planets, the nearby planets, actually are planets, and you suspect they could be stars. That's what you say?
Not exactly. So if you have the exoplanet closest, it's moving, it's orbiting, and when it's closest to the star, you probably get an impression in terms of the spectrum reception that you are observing two stars and not a star and an exoplanet.
I'm not sure, no, I don't think so, actually. When we have, for example, a hot Jupiter, let's say that we have a hot Jupiter. So a hot Jupiter is a planet very near its stars. The distance between the planet and the star is just a few percent of the distance between the sun and our sun and the Earth. So it's a very nearby planet to its stars. I think we have no doubt that actually there are planets, because a lot of them are detected both in radial velocity and in transit. So we have a very coherent picture of the scenario, which is a planet orbiting a star very near the star. And it's clear it's not a star, it's not a binary star, because if it would have been a star is more massive, thousands of times, hundreds of times more massive than a planet. And so the radial velocity variation won't be a few meters per second, but will be a few kilometers per second. So we can distinguish that. And again, if it's a star, actually, if it's solar type stars, it will be about the same size of the sun. So if we have two stars of that size, if we have a transit, the depth of the transit won't be 1%, but it will be 10, 20, 50%. This is not what we observe. All the planetary transits that we observe, they are very shallow transits. So now I think that it's clear we cannot mix binary stars and planetary stars, except where here maybe it's what you were talking about. If we have a blended binary star, a binary star blending in the light of a third star, but in that case, that's true that in that case we can have made a mixed up between a planet and a star, but in that case there is no particular link with the fact that this is a nearby planet. Actually, for a nearby planet or a more distant planet, the issue, the problem is about the same.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. But many students working on exoplanets, specialist. There is no question. Okay, so we, on behalf of all students, we thank you very, very much. And I give you an appointment on Tuesday.
With pleasure. So I'll be here. And once again, I'm sorry not to be here with you in Marrakech. So I hope there will be other opportunities when the situation will be easier for everybody.
I hope so. So I think Tuesday is in French. So, okay. Ah, Iman.
Voilà, juste une petite remarque. Vous n'avez pas parlé des exolunes ou des exocomètes quand même, hein?
J'ai un petit peu parlé des exolunes quand je vous ai dit que j'ai parlé d'une planète géante habitable qui éventuellement pouvait avoir un satellite. Mais en effet, les exosatellites, il y avait quelques candidats, mais il n'y en a pas beaucoup, donc c'est encore un sujet naissant, mais c'est très intéressant. Et les exocomètes, par contre, là, il y a beaucoup de résultats, donc en effet, j'en ai pas parlé, mais il y a beaucoup de résultats sur les exocomètes, notamment, on vient d'en publier un. Si vous allez sur le site web de l'Institut d'astrophysique de Paris, iap.fr, vous verrez, on vient de sortir un article sur la détection d'une trentaine d'exocomètes, et elles sont très intéressantes parce qu'elles ont des propriétés très similaires aux comètes qu'on a dans notre système solaire. Et donc, c'est la première fois qu'on mesure ça et c'est très intéressant.
Qu'on appelle les planètes chtoniennes, non ?
Ah non, c'est encore autre chose. Mais donc, vous connaissez bien nos travaux parce que les planètes chtoniennes aussi, on l'a proposé à l'IAP. Donc, les planètes chtoniennes, ce sont ce qu'on imagine des résidus d'évaporation. On a détecté il y a quelques années à l'IAP, à l'Institut d'astrophysique de Paris, avec des observations du télescope spatial Hubble, un Jupiter chaud qui s'évaporait, qui perdait son atmosphère. Et donc, on s'est dit, quel est le nom, qu'est-ce qui reste une fois que toute l'atmosphère s'est évaporée? On appelle ça des planètes chtoniennes. Alors ça, ce n'est pas encore confirmé, c'est quelque chose qui est issu, c'est une prédiction. Il y a encore du travail à faire pour savoir si c'est une planète chtonienne. En effet, planète chtonienne et exocomète, c'est un peu différent.
OK. On va remercier une deuxième fois et on vous donne rendez-vous donc le jeudi. Et merci encore pour votre implication, votre aide et surtout votre disponibilité pendant au moins une année qu'on écrit des mails pour avoir ce rendez-vous. Et donc, je réitère mes remerciements au nom de tous les étudiants étrangers africains. On a arabes au Moyen-Orient, c'est un peu très diversifié. Et donc, ça nous a fait très, très plaisir de vous avoir comme speaker. Merci et je vous donne rendez-vous à jeudi.
Merci beaucoup, ça m'a fait plaisir à moi aussi. À bientôt, au revoir.